A 6-year-old male child who is a child with a chronic neurological disorder since 2.5 years of age and who is under a follow-up in a tertiary care hospital has been brought by his mother with the complaints that he has been progressively having worsening of the symptoms. So, history of presenting illness. This boy was apparently normal till 2.5 years. He was walking, running, scribbling, playing with his sibling, and he's also spoken small sentences with normal vision and hearing. Hence, he was enrolled in his preschool. Mother there found him to have some issues, that is, he was weaker than his peer group. There was progressive worsening of the symptoms in the next few months. He had a history of difficulty in walking and running. He had a history of difficulty in climbing up and down the stairs. He preferred to sit and play more than standing. He also had a history of difficulty standing up from the sitting position, and he used to climb on himself for the same. And he also needed the help of his parents more than before for ambulation. So probing more into the history, we could find that there was a history of more proximal muscle involvement, both in the lower and the upper limbs. In the lower limbs, he had a difficulty to get up from the chair, difficulty in climbing up and down the stairs, and he also had frequent falls while walking. However, he was able to use his footwear with no slippage and no dragging of foot while walking, indicating a proximal muscle involvement of the lower limb. There was history of difficulty in combing his hair, difficulty in reaching for objects at a higher location, and he was able to write, button his shirt, remove shoes and socks, eat and mix his food, and he also screw tap open and open the bottle normally. So there was a history of proximal muscle involvement in the upper limbs as well. There was a history that he was walking, his walking was becoming funny, that he was swaying to the sides. However, he did not sway on standing. He had no difficulty in holding the objects and releasing the objects. And he also has, the mother gives a history that he gives a normal handshake. There are no abnormal movements identified by the mother. But the mother says that he looks weaker and thinner than before, but his calf appears to be bulky. There is no history of any stiffness or flailiness. There is no history of any higher mental function involvement, as its speech was normal. There are no abnormal movements, no seizures, no loss of consciousness, or no changes in the behavior. His sleep pattern is also normal. He had no disturbances during the nighttime. He did not snore, and he had never had an early morning headache or a need for frequent naps in the daytime. There is no history of cranial nerve involvement. He had normal smell. Vision was normal. There is no squinting or head tilt. His facial sensations and chewing is also normal. The facial symmetry seems to be normal by the mother. And there is no history of eye opening during sleep or partial eye opening during sleep. There is no history of any drooling or taste disturbance. His hearing is said to be normal. And there is no history of any swallowing difficulty or nasal regurgitation. His shoulder movements and neck movements are normal. And he also has a normal tongue position on opening the mouth. There is no history of any sensory nerve involvement. He had normal sensations, and he's also able to perceive warmth and cold temperature as well. There is no history of any cerebellar involvement, as he was balancing normally. He did not fall or sway on standing. His speech was normal. There is no flailness or change in handwriting. And he's also able to bring the food and water to his mouth without spillage, indicating there is no intention tremor. There is no history of any bowel and bladder involvement. He did not have incontinence, constipation, or diarrhea. He passed normal urine and stools, which are normal in color. There is no history of any autonomic involvement, no abnormal sweating, dizziness, palpitations, or syncope. The mother gives a history that she noticed increasing curvature of the spine. However, there is no back pain or tenderness. There is no history of any change in the head size. On a history of day-to-day regular activities, he wakes up from his bed with difficulty, but he brushes his own teeth and can bath on his own with some assistance for fetching water. He can eat on his own, but he requires the help of his mother to use the Indian toilet. He needs to be carried inside the house, which is in the ground floor, and he's coping well with his preschool academics and can play with his brother with some assistance for toys which have fallen away from him. And his sleep pattern is also normal. There is no history of any breathlessness, palpitations, or edema, or no history of any frequent respiratory tract infections, and none of these symptoms required any hospitalization. And there is no history of any contractures. All the symptoms did not vary diurnally or with exertion. They were not episodic as well. There is no history of any triggering or relieving factors. There is no history of pain, fever, rash, or muscle tenderness, and no history of trauma. So for all these above complaints, he was evaluated in a nearby GH where they found him to have some abnormal blood investigation. And he was referred to a tertiary care center. At the tertiary center, he was admitted and evaluated. Mother says they had he had been done some genetic testing. Both the mother and sibling were screened with the same blood test that they did in the GH. And they said the sibling was normal and the mother had elevated levels. They advised the child has a progressive muscular problem and they taught him physiotherapy, nutritional support was advised, and they were prescribed some oral drugs, but the parents discontinued those drugs in a week due to socioeconomic reasons. The genetic results came after a year at his 3.5 years, and which said to have confirmed the diagnosis. And hence they got involved with an NGO and they're continuously on physiotherapy and yoga through annual camps and online. However, despite this physiotherapy over the past 3.5 years, the symptoms have been progressively worsening, and it's more so in the past 1 year. So currently at 6 years, he seems to have an increased dependency. However, he's ambulant inside the house at ground level. The child has a history of frequent falling while walking, and hence he's scared to walk without support. He is unable to climb stairs even one step at a time, and the house is in the ground floor with two steps, and parents have to carry him inside. He rolls over and climbs on himself on waking from bed, and he takes more time than before to get up from his bed. He has difficulty in riding his tricycle, which he seems to have been riding well in the past. He sits and plays with his brother and has difficulty moving around. He's unable to throw balls overhead, which he seemed to have been doing well in the before 2.5 years. And he predominantly stays indoors because of all this, and he's become silent with an increased screen time. The mother also noticed an increase in curvature of the spine over the past three and a half years. So past history-wise, he's never been hospitalized before 2.5 years, and he's not on any drugs. He's an episodic visa requiring nebulizations on OP basis once or twice in a year with no requirement of any MDI therapy. Treatment history-wise, he's on physiotherapy for 3.5 years. Daily, he's doing at home all 7 days in a week. And he does 15 to 20 minutes before sleep. Child is reluctant to do the physiotherapy in the morning time. He's on both physical therapy and incentive spirometry. He also attends yoga through an online class, which he seems to be enjoying well. They have a regular attendance to an NGO camp that occurs annually, and they're under regular follow-up with a nearby DEIC for echocardiogram and thyroid function test. However, the past 1 year had been difficult with the pandemic, and they've never been followed up. But this device...
Lalita, yes, we would like you to stop here because the present history and past history contains the most important information about the case history. So we will discuss about the history you presented. You go back to the first slide.
Okay.
Dr. Sangeeta, can you start the question?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Dr. Lalita, you have actually said the child was brought with a difficulty in walking and frequent falls while walking. That was the predominant complaints, is it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So you going on to the next slide. You said you have screened the neuro axis. For the lower limb, you have screened the history like he had difficulty in getting up from starting position, difficulty in climbing up downstairs. And also he has frequent falls while walking. And this is mainly for the proximal group of the muscles. And for the distal group, you have asked for the difficulty in gripping the slippers and also dragging a foot while walking. Was there any history of difficulty in kicking balls for the intermediate group of muscles?
No, ma'am. Actually, was playing well, ma'am, till 2.5 years. But right now, he has a difficulty in standing without support also. So he's unable to kick the balls right now, ma'am.
Okay. And is he having any, did he have any preference to walk on toes? Was there any toe walking?
No, ma'am. There's no preference for toe walking, ma'am. He walks with some swaying only, ma'am.
Okay, so when you're asking for the lower limb history, always ask symptoms confining to the proximal, intermediate and the distal group of muscles. Okay? And moving on to the trunk, your truncal muscles, you have to ask whether he had difficulty in rolling over in the bed. Did he have any difficulty?
Yes, ma'am. He does have a difficulty. Yes, ma'am.
A difficulty in rolling over in the bed. Okay. Yes, and then moving on to the neck muscles, you have to say whether he has any difficulty in rising from lying position, supine position on the bed. Is he able to pull himself to the sitting position, or he turns to one side and then pull himself to the sitting position, or requires support to come to the sitting position?
Ma'am, previously he was actually able to wake up from the supine position, ma'am. Right now he is turning over to one side and he is climbing on himself to.
So he has some neck flexor weakness as well. So he has difficulty in rising from the lying down position. So you have to screen the symptoms from the lower limbs, truncal neck, and then you have to move on to the upper limbs. In the upper limbs, you have to again say ask symptoms for the proximal, intermediate, and the distal group. So for the distal group, you have asked difficulty in writing, buttoning or unbuttoning shirts, or opening a bottle, or closing a lock. And for the intermediate group, taking foot to mouth, or proximal group of muscles, you have asked for the difficulty in combing hair or reaching for objects which is higher in location. So when you're describing these symptoms, you have to also tell about the symptoms of the respiratory muscle involvement as well as the cranial and bulbar muscles. So cranial, I think you have already screened the cranial nerves, but it has to be more elaborate. Can you go back to the next slide? So in the cranial muscles, particularly for the child with a muscle disease, Elliment syndrome, pure motor syndrome. So if you're asking 3, 4, 6, you have to say whether there was any squint, drooping of eyelids, whether there was any squint, whether there was any restriction of eyeball movements. So that because children with the Elliment syndrome, particularly neuromuscular junction defect or a muscular dystrophy, few of the muscular dystrophy can present with ptosis, they can present with external ophthalmoparesis. So that history has to be there, okay? And then when you're asking about the fifth nerve, you have to ask about whether there is a difficulty in chewing, which you have already mentioned. And for the seventh nerve, rather than asking for the facial asymmetry alone, which more, if it is a bilateral weakness, you might not get a facial asymmetry. If it's a unilateral, you will get it. So bilateral weakness, how will you elicit? So you have to ask whether there is any difficulty in drinking with a straw, or any difficulty in blowing balloons, or any difficulty in whistling. So these are the symptoms which they usually present with. And sometimes children during sleep, they sleep with the eyes open. So when they have bifacial weakness, they sleep with the eyes open. So these history has to be checked in the for the facial nerve. And for the hearing, we have already asked for nasal twang and nasal regurgitation, and any change in the voice volume, whether there is any hypophonia or decrease in voice volume also has to be checked. Okay. So once you screen the system, then you won't miss out any of the symptoms. Lower limb, truncal, neck, and then the upper limb, and then the cranial, bulbar, and the respiratory muscles. For the respiratory muscles, we have already clearly brought out the symptoms. There was any breathing difficulty or any exertional dyspnea, for the cardiac involvement also you have already asked. And also you have to clearly say at the end of the screening of the symptoms, you have to say about the diurnal variation there itself rather than taking it to the back. You have told the diurnal variation, but you have to bring it at the end of the at the motor symptoms. So you can say whether there is any diurnal variation of the weakness and whether there is any history of easy fatigability. That's very important. So whether there is any, does the child become tired after walking for some distance, he takes rest for some time and then again he resumes his activity, whether there is any fatigability of the during the activities, motor activities. Okay. And then plainness of the stiffness of the limbs also has to be brought out along there that we have already mentioned in your history. And also you have to mention about whether there was any muscle pain, cramps or any myoglobinuria. So that also has to be brought along with the motor symptoms when you are saying the history of the motor symptoms. Okay. Muscle pain, muscle cramps and myoglobinuria. Why is it important?
Could be because of some metabolic myopathies also.
So muscle pain and cramps are typically seen with the metabolic myopathies. Myoglobinuria, again, you can get it metabolic myopathies. But in addition, muscle pain and cramps can be present in sometimes in inflammatory myopathies also, and you can rarely have it in some of the muscular dystrophies. So that history is important. Okay. And you have rightly brought out the any worsening of the symptoms with the intercurrent illness, whether it is episodic, you have already told in your history. So episode, in addition to that, you have to clearly say what are the aggravating relieving factors. What are the typical aggravating factors you have asked for?
Exercise, okay. Fasting, okay. Then carbohydrate meal.
Okay.
Then we asked about cold, exposure to cold.
So why is it important?
Ma'am, it could be because of periodic paralysis, ma'am.
Okay. So fever and fasting particularly important because of metabolic myopathies. So they can decompensate during the intercurrent illness when there is a catabolic stress. And other channelopathies can worsen with the high carbohydrate diet or exposure to cold. So that is why you ask for these aggravating factors. And also you have to ask for the history of muscle twitching. So that is important for the anterior onset disease. So you have to mention in the history whether there is any twitching of the muscles observed by the parents. Okay. So these are the few histories, additional thing you wish you need to add up. And you have already rightly brought out that sleep disorder breathing, the history. So you have clearly mentioned there is no early morning headache or a fragmented sleep at night or excessive daytime sleepiness. That is an indirect indicator of the sleep disorder breathing at night. And any snoring also you have already mentioned. So these are the things which I would like to add up in the history. So anything else, sir?
Thank you, Prasannita. We'll just start from where you ended. Lalita, you told that the onset was at 2.5 years.
Yes, sir.
So can you tell me a few conditions where they can have weakness at birth, weakness in the infancy, and weakness at this age group? Can you tell me some few conditions?
Yes, sir. So weakness at birth is because of some congenital myopathies, or it may be because of other syndromes like Down syndrome or
Prader-Willi. Myasthenia gravis, sir.
Congenital myasthenia gravis.
Myotonic dystrophy all can sometime present in the newborn period. And how do they present?
Say they present at birth with respiratory distress or even birth asphyxia. So they can present like that, requiring ventilatory support, and resuscitation also at birth might be needed for them, sir. And
sometimes they may not be even able to suck well and may require feeding for a longer period than what required. Suppose weakness pressing in infancy, what condition can present in infancy?
Pompe's SMA, sir.
Okay. So you nicely discussed about the proximal muscle involvement in both sides. So what do you think the possible anatomical level of this? And then beyond that, how do you proceed?
Sir, anatomical level wise, it could be more of an LMN lesion, sir, more than UMN lesion.
So we have ruled out the UMN because the child did not have seizures, sir, or any altered sensorium or any abnormal movements. Then we come down in the LMN. For the spinal cord, we have ruled out the child is not having any bladder bowel disturbance, sir. Then we have in the LMN lesion, the neuro from neuro axis, there is no child is not having any peripheral neuropathy, features suggestive of peripheral neuropathy.
Like sensory disturbance
is not there, sir. Then in neuromuscular junction, there's no variation in the child's weakness or regarding his movement disorders. And so we came down to the child be having a muscular pathologies.
Can you analyze about the muscle pathology? Now you feel that it's more likely to be a muscle pathology. How do you proceed beyond that?
Muscle.
Is it an inherited one or acquired one?
Sir, it could be either an acquired cause or an inherited cause, sir. So acquired cause are mostly.
What are the inherited group of conditions? Can you tell me some inherited group of condition which affects the muscles?
Yes, sir.
Professor Sangeeta, you can intervene anytime when we go on the wrong side.
Sure, sir.
The inherited could be congenital myopathies, sir, or muscular dystrophies, or metabolic myopathies can also, or channelopathies can present with as inherited muscle. Acquired could be because of dermatomyositis or drug-induced toxic myopathies.
Yes,
okay. Or endocrine causes can also cause. Hypothyroidism, even hyperthyroidism can cause, sir. Hyperparathyroidism.
Okay.
Yes.
Then
drugs like steroids, chloroquine, zidovudine can all cause.
Okay, you discussed about all the various types of disorder which will affect the muscle. What do you think more likely from the history you presented?
Sir, this could more likely
be a congenital myopathy or can it be a metabolic myopathy? You just tell one sentence about each. How do they present? How your case is different from these?
Sir, we are thinking more in terms of an inherited condition, sir. Though the child presented at 2.5 years of age, muscular dystrophies can like Duchenne muscular dystrophy or Becker's may present at a later age group, sir. Or even SMA type 3 can also present at childhood age group, sir.
Okay, so, we are discussing about muscle disease. So.
Yes, sir. Yes. Second-wise, congenital myopathies, there might be an history since birth. And the child may also have other features like myopathic faces can be present or but they will not be that progressive. They are non-progressive disorders, sir. So we can think in terms of a muscular dystrophy than a congenital myopathy.
Metabolic myopathy and channelopathies, usually they will be intermittent. Trigger factors will be there. Cramps, all this will be there. And madam asked about myoglobinuria. Can you tell me, suppose the child develops myoglobinuria, what will be there? Can you tell me about the presentation and the differential diagnosis? What will be the child has myoglobinuria, what will be the urine color?
Urine color will be tea colored or red colored urine.
Okay, what are the other differential diagnosis of myoglobinuria? when you look at a
color, hematuria and hemoglobinuria can be present.
Can you, how do you differentiate these three, hematuria, hemoglobinuria and myoglobinuria? Because we don't see myoglobinuria very often.
Yes, sir. Hematuria under microscopy, urine routine, the microscopy will reveal red blood cells, sir.
Okay.
And for hemoglobinuria and myoglobinuria, we can take the sample and do a centrifugation, and the supernatant can be examined, sir. If it is pink in color, it is probably a hemoglobinuria, sir.
Sorry,
in myoglobinuria,
it will be absent.
Yes, sir.
In addition, the investigation probably CPK will be raised.
CPK will be elevated, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Anything, Professor Sangeeta, when we ask them to continue?
Yes, sir, we can proceed.
Okay. Yes, Salita, you can continue.
Yes,
there.
So moving on to the birth history, we were not able to elicit anything significant related to the disease. However, his growth signs in the antenatal period showed reduction in the fetal growth and oligohedromnias, making him a term IUGF baby of 1.8 kg, and he required NICU admission for the same, and he was observed for 4 days and he was discharged for that. He did not require any ventilator or oxygen support during the time, and there were no convulsions or sepsis even during the postnatal period. Developmental wise, he achieved all his milestones, age appropriate milestones.
Was there any mal presentation? Was there any mal presentation? Quickening was present.
No, ma'am. No, ma'am.
There was no delayed quickening.
No, ma'am. He no delayed quickening, ma'am. The quickening was felt at second trimester only, and he perceived fetal movements well throughout the pregnancy. The mother felt, and he was actually born by a LSCS delivery, ma'am.
It was a vertex precipitation.
Yes, ma'am. Vertex only, ma'am. There was no abnormal movement or anything. Ma'am.
Okay. Was there any feeding difficulty in the newborn period?
No, ma'am. Feeding was initiated with an artificial feed initially for the mother's insufficiency only, ma'am. He had a normal feeding pattern, and he was able to take his breast milk directly from breast by around 4 to 5 hours only, ma'am.
Did not have any breathing difficulty, did not
no
require any oxygen support.
No, okay. No. Developmental-wise, he achieved all age-appropriate milestones in all domains. However, gross motor milestones are now delayed since 2.5 years of age by his weakness. At 2.5 years, he jumps with difficulty. At 3 years, he rides the tricycle, but with difficulty. At 4-5 years, he has difficulty in getting up, walking, standing, and climbing, which he achieved age-appropriately. Fine motor skills, language and social and adaptive skills were normally achieved. He does not have any behavioral abnormality, hyperactiveness or impulsivity. He's a calm child and he's socializing well. So moving on to the nutritional history.
One minute, Lalita.
Yes.
Do you expect in a child with the suspected neuromuscular disorder like DMD, do you expect any delay in speech and other cognitive?
Yes, sir. Cognitive delay can be present. Speech delay can also be present, sir. And also DMD may have associated ADHD or autism spectrum disorders can be there, sir.
Okay, go ahead.
Nutrition-wise, he's on predominantly a vegetarian diet with a good adequate dietary fiber intake and micronutrients as well. By a 24-hour recall method, he had a calorie deficit of 33% and his protein intake is adequate. There is no food fatism, intolerance or allergy. And immunization-wise, he is immunized according to the national immunization schedule. Optional vaccines are yet to be taken, and there were no adverse reactions encountered during any time. Family history-wise, is the second born of a non-consanguineous marriage. They are a four-member family. There is no history of any neuromuscular disorders or weakness in anyone in the family. There was no history of any sudden or premature deaths as well. He has an elder brother who is a 10-year-old boy who is normal. And there was one MTP previous to his conception for social reasons. Moving on to the socioeconomic and environmental history.
Is there any family history of any endocrine disorders?
No, ma'am. The mother said all of them are normal and they do not have any other issues.
Any early onset diabetes or thyroid disorders?
No, ma'am.
Why is it important?
Hypothyroidism itself might cause neuromuscular disease like this, ma'am.
Asking family history. Family history of early onset endocrinopathies. So myotonic dystrophy can present the systemic manifestations can be there. So it's an autosomal dominant inherited disorder. So there might be a family history of early onset diabetes mellitus or thyroid disorders, and they can have this cataract and frontal baldness. So not only the history of neuromuscular disorders, you can ask even for contractures or deformities also, because many of the times they won't come with a history of muscle weakness per se. So any contractures, deformities, or any endocrine disorders. Okay.
And even some of them even have cardiomyopathy, isn't that, Professor Angina?
Yes.
They can also have cardiomyopathy with minimal motor symptoms. That is also one of the presentations.
Okay, sir. Shall I proceed, sir?
Yes, please.
Social history, they live in a pakka house in a ground floor, and they have a separate kitchen, toilet, and two rooms are present. They live in a calm housing area. No modifications have been done for his ambulation or for his assistance. The father is a skilled labor worker and mother is a nursing graduate, and they belong to a lower middle class according to modified Kupusami scale. The child attends a nearby government school for his kindergarten, and though the school is at a walkable distance from home, he needs to be carried by his parents for the same. The teachers are aware of his disease. Elder brother is also friendly and affectionate with them, and he also helps them. There are some affordability issues with physiotherapy. There is no nearby physiotherapy or a multidisciplinary clinic, and hence they attend the DEIC in the district, which needs a traveling of 1 hour. However, in the past 1 year, they have not been followed back due to pandemic.
Two things I want to know, Lalita. How is the parents understand that this is a disease of chronic disease, progressive disease? Do they understand?
Yes, sir. The mother is actually a nursing graduate, sir. Though she discontinued and she's not working, she is able to understand the disease per se, sir. And they've been regularly a part of some non-governmental organization that helps these kids with chronic diseases also, sir. And she was also able to give us proper history as well, and was able to tell how the child's disease is progressing, and they have a clear understanding of the disease.
Okay, you written as no modifications then. Suppose you are the doctor to them, and what modifications in the house or school you will suggest?
Preferably the house or the school to be on the ground floor, sir. So the child can ambulate easily, and in case he loses his ambulation, so that he will be able to go to school and move about in his school with a wheelchair or assist devices like crutches, sir.
Quality of life better?
Having rails in the side can help him be mobile at home, and even in the bathroom they can have rails for him to as a support, sir.
And then it must be smooth surface so that he doesn't slip, avoid obstacles. Yes, and also even in the bathroom they should have some grab some rings or some whole chain so that he doesn't fall inside the bathroom. All this we are likely to cause fractures, so all this modification may be helpful. Suppose the ground or first floor, if it's affordable, they can even have a lift rather than carrying him. And these are all things available, of course, depends on the economical background. Okay, can some of the
So summary of the history: he's a 6-year-old male with a chronic neurological problem since 2.5 years, with a progressive difficulty in the ability of the proximal muscles of both the upper and the lower limb, and also of the trunk muscles, with an increasing dependency. He's ambulant inside the home at ground level, and he has never been hospitalized for any complications of the disease, and there are no predisposing or a triggering factor, and there is no family history as well. So we'd like to discuss the level of the lesion, sir. We would like to place the level of the lesion at the lower motor neuron level.
Summary, Lalita. Yes. It has to be a 6-year-old child born to non-consanguineous parents, presenting with progressive weakness, proximal muscle weakness involving both upper and lower limbs, with neck flexor weakness and frontal weakness, without any diurnal variation or fatigability, with no episodic worsening and no aggravating or relieving factors, with no positive family history. So that should be your progression. That should be a summary. So, because it will say whether it is a anatomical localization would be there in your summary, proximal or distal, whether it's a symmetrical or asymmetrical, whether it's upper limb, lower limb, or cranial bulbar or the respiratory muscles. So, you and what is the mode of progression? So, everything should be there in the summary.
Yes. Okay. So we'd like to place the level of lesion at the lower motor neuron level, ma'am, because there are no upper motor neuron involvement. There are no cognition difficulty. Speech was normal. No cranial nerve involvement. No cerebellar symptoms were also present. And there was no spasticity by history. And there was no bladder and bowel involvement indicating of a spinal cord lesion or there was no obvious sensory level also by history. So we would like to probably think as a lower motor level neuron level. And at the lower motor neuron, we would like to think as a primary muscular because in anterior horn cells, there will be asymmetrical involvement and there could be atrophy of the muscles. But the mother said, give a clear history of bulky calves, ma'am.
What asymmetry would be there in an anterior horn cell disease? Which anterior horn cell disease are talking about?
Yeah, that is wrong, I think. No asymmetry generally. Okay.
Hey, anterior horn cell disease could be inherited or acquired. So inherited disorder is spinal muscular atrophy of three types, 1, 2, 3. And acquired disorders would be your polio virus infection or non-polio enterovirus or West Nile virus infection. So usually in an acquired disorder, you can have an asymmetry, but usually what you see clinical commonly is, and this kind of chronic disorder is an inherited anterior horn cell disease. So inherited anterior horn cell disease would be a symmetrical weakness. And the wasting will be disproportionate to the weakness. And usually the proximal will be more involved than the distal. So this is how you have it typically in the SMA children.
Okay.
And the nerve disease also, again, it's not always asymmetrical. If it is like an inherited disorders like hereditary motor sensory neuropathy. So you will have a motor symptoms, sensory symptoms, and then you will have usually symmetrical weakness. And it will be predominantly distal more than proximal. Okay, and in the if you categorize at the level of neuromuscular junction need not always have extraocular or pharyngeal involvement. Of course, that is one of the point, but there is no fatigability or diurnal variation of the symptoms. And from it could be again a congenital or acquired cause. Congenital is congenital myasthenic syndrome, which can manifest early, and acquired myasthenia is due to the antibody mediator. And if it is a muscle, then you have pointed out it is a symmetrical weakness involving proximal muscles without any sensory involvement, and there is some selective hypertrophy of the calf muscles. So if it is muscular, again you have to say whether it's a muscular dystrophy or it is a myotonic dystrophy or it's an inflammatory myopathy or it's a metabolic myopathy.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. The onset is at childhood, ma'am. So we could not think in terms of a congenital myopathy. It's a chronic and inherited disease, which is also progressive, may point towards more of a muscular dystrophy, ma'am. And there are no features suggestive of a metabolic or a channelopathy because there is no triggering factor. There was no episodic illness. And usually a bulky calf is usually more of a dystrophy, muscular dystrophy feature, ma'am. So we consider more of a muscular dystrophy, and most common muscular dystrophy that we encounter is Duchenne muscular dystrophy. Hence,
so bulky calf muscles, you have it only in Duchenne muscular dystrophy?
No, ma'am, it's not pathognomic, but it can be present in
what,
Duchenne.
What other condition can have this?
So Becker's can also have, sir, but at this age, they will not present early. Other conditions like with hypothyroidism, Kocher debris semialagny syndrome can have. And
can we say, Professor Sangeeta, the absence of muscle tenderness, pain, and rashes is unlikely to be due to inflammatory muscle disease? Right?
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. The inflammatory you will have for the other systemic features, so skin rashes, the typical skin rashes, Godfrey papules, heliotrope rash, and the Shawl sign.
Rashes,
and then they can have fever, and then they can have muscle pain and muscle tenderness. See, a process of calf muscle hypertrophy, it could be a true hypertrophy or a pseudo hypertrophy. So true hypertrophy, you have it in the myotonia congenita and paramyotonia congenita. In the pseudo hypertrophy, you have it in the Duchenne muscular dystrophy, Becker muscular dystrophy, sarcoglycanopathy. So the immediate differential diagnosis of Duchenne muscular dystrophy at this age would be sarcoglycanopathy. And also SMA type 3, Pompe's disease, and also hypothyroidism. So these are the causes for calf hypertrophy, pseudo hypertrophy of the calf muscles.
Prof. Sangeeta, can you tell some more about sarcoglycanopathies? Are they...
Sarcoglycanopathies is also a type of muscular, it is a limb girdle muscular dystrophy.
Mm-hmm.
It's an autosomal recessively inherited disorder. So in this, the Duchenne muscular dystrophy is a dystrophinopathy. So you have the mutation in the dystrophin gene or a deletion of the exons in the dystrophin gene. But in the sarcoglycanopathy, you have the mutations in the sarcoglycan gene. So they have alpha, beta, gamma, and delta four subtypes.
What are they different from DMD clinically?
Clinically, it will closely mimic Duchenne muscular dystrophy, except for one type, gamma sarcoglycanopathy, where they will have more of hip adductors weakness. So they will have a hip abductor sign. So when the child rises from the sitting position to the standing position, he will abduct his hip to the maximum and then rise because his hip abductors are strong. So the rest of the types, usually they closely mimic Duchenne muscular dystrophy. So in a girl child with a DMD phenotype, then the differentials could be either it is a skewed X inactivation or it could be a Turner phenotype, XO with the manifesting the disease, or it could be a sarcoglycanopathy. So sarcoglycanopathy clinically, it will be like very closely mimicking the Duchenne muscular dystrophy. The diagnosis would be made mainly on the muscle biopsy. When you do an immunostaining, you will see absent staining of the sarcoglycans. In the Duchenne muscular dystrophy, you will see absent staining of the dystrophin. Here, you will see the absent staining of the sarcoglycans. Or the confirmation would be by the genetic testing.
Okay, thank you. Okay, you can go ahead with the examination. Huh?
Okay, sir.
Anything else you want to ask, Sankita?
No, sir. We can proceed to the examination.
40 minutes almost we have spent, I think. Okay.
On general examination, was an alert. He was alert, afebrile, and his hydration was good. There was no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, pedal edema, or lymphadenopathy. His vitals were stable. His pulse rate was around 97 per minute. It was regular in rhythm, normal in volume, no special character, and it was felt in all peripheral vessels. He had a respiratory rate of 24 per minute. It was regular, thoracic, and there was no, it was a normal work of breathing. BP was also in normal for his centile, height centile. It was around 100/60 in the right upper limb in the sitting position. Saturation was 98% and his temperature was 97.5 Fahrenheit. Anthropometry-wise, his height was in the third centile. Weight was between third to the 10th centile and the BMI was in the 10th centile. So moving on to the head to foot examination, scalp and head is normal. There is no dysmorphism and he has normal expressions. Eyes are normal, no squint, ptosis or cataract. Ear ENT examination is normal. The dental hygiene is good with all deciduous teeth. Then skin, normal pigmentation, no neurocutaneous markers, striae, dry skin, rashes or scars were seen. Nails are normal, well-trimmed and clean. There is no chest wall or abdominal deformities. Genitalia is normal with both the testes and the scrotum and no phimosis. Extremities are bilaterally symmetrical, appear normal in length. Feet and hands are normal. Then calf muscle hypertrophy bilaterally could be seen. Spine, there is a scoliosis. There are no contractures, no features suggestive of hypothyroidism like dry skin or obesity or hernia, and BCG scar is seen.
Lalita, you have to mention about eyelids, you have to mention violaceous rashes, you have to mention about knuckles, is there any pigmentation?
Sir, no rashes and normal pigmentation throughout, sir, and no rashes anywhere in the body, sir.
What are the ocular signs you look for in a child with the muscle disease?
Ocular signs, there could be ptosis, ma. Then squint can also be present.
Okay. Restriction of movement of eyes in all directions, ma'am.
Ophthalmoparesis, yes. Then?
Cataract could be there and rashes.
Cataract, you will have it in?
Congenital myopathies.
Cataract, you have it in myotonic dystrophy. Okay.
Okay.
And then what are the findings, fundus findings?
Fundus findings are usually... usually in muscular dystrophy, they're normal, ma'am. But in metabolic myopathies, can see retinitis pigmentosa features.
Mitochondrial myopathies, they can have pigmentary retinopathy. And in the muscular dystrophy also, facial scapulohumeral muscular dystrophy, FSHMD, can have retinal vasculopathy. It's called as Coats disease. They have the retinal vasculopathy with the hearing loss.
Okay.
And you have to, in the general examination, also mention about the dysmorphic state, any facial dysmorphism is there, because you said the other human causes of hypotonia. You said Down syndrome, Prader-Willi syndrome you were discussing earlier. So any facial dysmorphism is there, you have to mention. And also you have to mention whether there is any myopathic phases. Myopathic phases, they typically have this bitemporal hollowing, they have an elongated faces, they have an Hayash palate, and then they can have this typical Kashmir mouth. So that you have to mention in the general examination. And also you have mentioned about the contractures. Contractures has to be mentioned, and any deformities, pescabers or hammer toes, any deformities are there, you have to mention. And any trophic ulcers are there also has to be mentioned. Okay. And also you have to mention about the hyperlaxity of joints when you're mentioning about the contractures, because there are certain congenital muscular dystrophy. Your Ulrich and Bethlen collagen 6 mutation related myopathies, where they can have hyperlaxity of the joints. So that also has to be mentioned. Okay.
Okay.
Testes you have mentioned already. Bilateral testes, descended, because of hypogonadism and undescended testes, again you have to look for specificity. Okay.
Okay.
Please proceed.
Yes. Moving on to the neurological examination. On higher mental functions, he's a conscious, cheerful child, and he's oriented to time, place, and person, and he has normal speech. There is no dysarthria or dysphasia. Cranial nerve functions, all cranial nerves were normal, ma'am. Shall I proceed or?
Yeah, no need to elaborate. So what specifically you are interested is, one is 3, 4, 6.
3, 4, 6.
Yeah, and others is 7th, 5th nerve for masseter temporal is wasting, you have to look at, and jaw jerk, and jaw movements you have to look at, elevation, depression, and side-to-side movements of jaw. And 7th nerve, closure of eyes, and the whether I'm able to blow the cheek. And also 8th nerve, sensory neural hearing loss, and the 9, 10. These are the cranial involvement which you commonly see in the children with the muscle diseases, neuromuscular disorders. Okay. Tongue fasciculation has to be mentioned. You have written tongue movements, so you have to mention about the wasting of tongue and tongue fasciculation also.
Sangeeta, I just want to clarify a doubt. So gag reflex is generally not done, no? Usually we are expected by examiners because it's very unpleasant for a child. You just mentioned as good palatal movements, no pulling of secretions. Is it enough, or the examiner will expect the gag reflex to be done?
So, if it is a element syndrome where you expect a bulbar weakness, definitely it is mandatory to do it. So mentioning the position of uvula and palatal movements wouldn't be sufficient. So we have to mention the gag reflex also.
Second, about the corneal reflex, is it enough that we do the conjunctival reflex, or corneal reflex has to be done?
One is sufficient.
Because again, invasive. Yes,
corneal reflex is enough.
Okay, thank you. I proceed, Lalita.
Okay. Motor system examination, he assumes a lordotic posture, Gower sign is positive, and he has a waddling gait. On examination of the bulk, on inspection, there is infraspinatus and deltoid hypertrophy. Valley sign is positive. There is wasting of the thigh muscles, and also there is bilateral calf muscle hypertrophy. On palpation of these hypertrophied muscles, they are firm and they are not tender. Measurement of these at identical points, all areas were symmetrical. Tone was reduced in all four limbs.
What is valley sign?
Valley sign is a pathognomic of Duchenne muscular dystrophy, ma'am. It is because of the deltoid and the infraspinatus hypertrophy along with the anterior axillary fold atrophy, ma'am. So there will be...
It's a posterior axillary fold.
Yes. Oh, posterior. Okay, ma'am.
So the photo you have clearly shown, no? You ask the child to update the limb with the hands facing upwards. And then you look for the valley sign. There you can see the... infraspinous hypertrophy as one mount and deltoid hypertrophy as one mount, and the valley that the depth of the valley would be the wasting of the posterior axillary fold. Okay, what are the name signs are there in muscular dystrophy?
Valley sign.
Pratan is a
person. Pratan has described it.
Very rarely only we get signs after the Indian names, Indian doctors.
So valley sign, and have you heard of Polly Hill sign?
Because of various muscle hypertrophies, ma'am.
Yeah. Polyhill sign, yeah, you see in facial scapulohumeral dystrophy, there will be selective atrophy and wasting of certain muscles, and the relative preservation or the hypertrophy of the other group of muscles is seen in the upper lip. So that's a polyhill sign which you see in FSHD. And there are a hip abductor sign, which I told, sarcoglycanopathy. And the Gower sign, which you see in the any proximal muscle weakness, and that is Duchenne muscular dystrophy, sarcoglycanopathy you typically see.
Shall I proceed, ma'am?
Yeah. And what are the group of muscles that are hypertrophied in the Duchenne muscular dystrophy? One is the cough muscle, gastrocnemius. What are the muscles?
The masseter and tongue muscles can be involved, ma'am, in the face. Yeah.
So in the lower limb, you will have gastrocnemius, and you can have vastus lateralis, and in the upper limb, you have the
Infraspinatus, deltoid, and brachioradialis can also be involved.
Infraspinatus and the deltoidus, and the masseter and tongue muscles. Yes.
On examination of the power, there was a proximal group weakness. Neck lifting was normal, ma'am, and trunk movement, he was able to roll over and get up, ma'am. And so it's,
flexors are the earliest to be involved in Duchenne muscular dystrophy. You said that he has difficulty in rising from lying position, so that means there is a neck flexor weakness. So neck lifting from lying position wouldn't be normal.
Okay, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Shoulder movements at abduction, adduction, flexion, and extension, it was grade 3. Elbow flexion and extension was of grade 4, and wrist flexion and extension is normal. Hand grip was also normal. On hip, on flexion, extension, abduction, adduction, it was grade 4, as well in knee flexion and extension. Ankle, plantar, and dorsiflexion was also grade 4.
Okay. Usually, Duchenne muscular dystrophy, it will be the low at the early course of the disease. The lower limb will be more involved than the upper limb. The proximal more than the distal. So usually, the hip pelvic girdle group of muscles will be more involved than the shoulder girdle.
Okay.
But in the course, late while the disease progresses, you can have proximal involvement of upper limb as well.
Okay.
And in the knee flexion extension, no? Extensors will be more weak than flexion. Flexion will be usually preserved till late. But if you see the knee extension, it will be weak. So there will be a gradient of weakness. So it will not be so symmetrical for the flexion extension. And again, for the plantar flexion and dorsiflexion, so they have a strong plantar flexion, the dorsiflexion would be weak.
All anti-gravity muscles. Huh?
Yeah. So that is why they developed this ankle contracture. Plantar flexors would be strong and the dorsiflexion would be slightly weak.
Okay.
Please proceed.
Yes. Reflexes wise, all deep tendon reflexes were elicitable. Ankle, we could elicit it better than other jerks. Plantars were flexor. Superficial reflexes were all present. There are no primitive pathological reflexes and there is no myotonia elicitable.
Myotonia?
Sir, percussion over the hypothenar, thenar eminence and hand grip we can see, and asking the child to...
When you percuss over the thenar eminence, what will you see?
That area will take some time to relax, sir. There will be a dimpling and it will take some time to relax because of the myotonia. And so the
flexion of thumb will be there and it will take some time to relax. Okay. What about the tongue?
Myotonia, you have percussion myotonia and grip myotonia, and also you have to look for paramyotonia. So percussion myotonia is, as you mentioned, you can percuss on any group of muscle. It could be any group of muscle which is involved. When you percuss on that, you will have a depression over the muscle mass, and then it will take a longer time to relax back to normal. Grip myotonia, when you shake hand or when you ask the child to hold the finger and ask the child to release the finger, then it will take a longer time to release. And paramyotonia is when you ask the child to repeatedly close and open his eyes, then he will develop myotonia on repeated exertion. That is paramyotonia. Okay. So you have to check for all this.
Okay. Sensory system wise, all sensations, touch, pain, temperature, pressure, vibration, and proprioception were intact. Cortical sensations are checked for completion sake and they're normal. And there is no cerebellar symptoms. There is no ataxia, nystagmus, dysmetria. He did normal finger nose test, finger nose test, heel knee test, and there is no dysdiadochokinesia. There are no involuntary movements. Spine and cranium examination wise, there is scoliosis which got corrected on bending. There is no tenderness or gibbous. There are no meningeal signs. Bladder is not palpable, and autonomic symptoms or raised ICP features were not present.
Okay. Have you mentioned about the gait?
Yes, ma'am. Gait, he had a waddling gait.
You haven't mentioned, I think.
First, initially we...
She started with the gait.
Okay. Sure. And then the PASIC tongue classification I have already told you. And then you have you have also mentioned about polymyny myoclonus. Polymyny myoclonus is you typically see in children with the spinal muscular atrophy type 2 and type 3. When you ask to stretch their arms forward, then you can have this myoclonus involving the fingers.
Sangeeta, I have a doubt here. How do you differentiate this from tremors? Generally, when we ask them to outstretch the fingers,
tremors will be a rhythmic oscillatory movement, sir.
Okay. Polymyoclonus.
Myoclonus, okay. Yes. So that you see in anterior horn cell disease. Another thing you have to mention about the beaver sign, you haven't mentioned. Bower sign you have mentioned, but beaver sign, when your abdominal muscles or truncal muscle weakness, you have to mention that. And also you have to mention about the forward arm abduction time, because if it is a neuromuscular disorder, there will be easy fatigability, and you have to ask the child to stretch his arm forward, and you have to count how many minutes he is able to stretch his arm forward. That's a forward arm abduction time. So if it is very much declined, then you have to do a fatigability test. You have to ask the child to do some exercise. For example, if you're examining the shoulder abductors, ask him to do the abduction for 10 times, and then prior to doing the exercise, you have to do the power assessment, and after the exercise, you have to do the power assessment again to look for any drop in the power after the exercise. These are small tests at the bedside to look for the fatigability. Okay.
Yeah. Lalita, can you explain? I'll just tell you these findings, and you explain the underlying mechanism, like lordotic gait.
It's because of the pelvic girdle muscle weakness, and mostly of the gluteus maximus.
Hip extensors.
So the child will assume there will be anterior pelvic tilt because of the weakness.
Gower sign?
Gower sign is because of the weakness of the hip extensors and knee extensors.
Extensors of the hip, knee, and okay. Gower sign. What about the waddling gait?
Waddling gait is because of the weakness of the gluteus maximus. Medius and maximus, sir. So, because of the weakness, the child will not be able to stand properly.
Stabilize the pelvis, sir. When the child is flexing one knee, the opposite gluteus medius will actually contract to stabilize the hip. When there's a weakness, they will have a...
They'll be swaying towards the side of the... Yes. So they'll be tilting on both sides.
Yes, sir.
Tilt to waddling gait. What about the toe walking?
Because of difference between the plantar and dorsal flexor.
Imbalance between the dorsiflexor and plantar flexors. Dorsiflexors are weak, that's why you have toe walking. Okay. Further, proceed further.
Other system examination, apex was in the left fifth intercostal space, medial to the metclavicular line. It was normal in character. There are no abnormal pulsations. Both the heart sounds were heard well and in all areas, and there is no murmur.
What are the muscle disease which can cause cardiac ailments?
Duchenne muscular dystrophy can cause dilated cardiomyopathy, sir, as well as in Becker's muscular dystrophy. Then Emery Dreifuss muscular dystrophy can cause cardiac myopathy. And sudden cardiac death can also be there, sir.
Pompies and mitochondrial.
Pompies also, yes.
Pompies and mitochondrial. They also can.
Respiratory system wise, chest expansion is good. Chest and abdomen rise is normal. And there are no paradoxical breathing. He has good cough reflex. Voice volume is normal. He had a single breath count of 20 per minute with normal vesicular breath sounds, and there are no added sounds. Abdomen wise, it was soft, non-tender. There is no ornomegaly, and bubble sounds were well heard. Shall I move on to the summary, sir?
I can.
So by history.
Sangeeta, anything else you want to ask in the clinical signs?
No, sir. I think they've covered up everything. The respiratory muscle involvement, which muscular muscle disorders you have?
Ma'am, diaphragmatic weakness
can be present.
Intercostal diaphragmatic weakness. So, which are muscular disorders? Which muscular disorders?
Ma'am, in the late stage, DMD we can have, and Becker's we can have diaphragmatic weakness.
Yes, muscular dystrophy. Metabolic myopathies you can have, inflammatory myopathies, congenital myopathies. All these can have present with the respiratory muscle involvement. Hepatic involvement?
hepatic with mitochondrial and metabolic
mitochondrial and pompies.
Pompies. Okay.
Summarize.
Okay. So by history, he's a 6-year-old male who had come with a chronic progressive muscle inability to use the proximal muscles since 2.5 years of age, with also involvement of the neck flexors and the trunk muscles, with no involvement triggering or a predisposing factor, and it was also not episodic, and so hence we proceeded thought of a lower motor neuron lesion at the level of muscles, which could be because of an inherited condition and probably of a muscular dystrophy. And by examination, we were able to identify calf muscle, intraspinatus, and deltoid pseudohypertrophy and proximal muscle weakness with a lordotic pressure and brisk ankle jerk, then other deep tendinitis flexors, the positive Gower sign and a Wadling gait, and also scoliosis. We would like to place a differential diagnosis of Duchenne muscular dystrophy as the first one, sir.
You can say it as a muscular dystrophy, and among the muscular dystrophy, you can give a list of differentials. You can give a Duchenne muscular dystrophy.
What are the other muscular dystrophies we offer the DD, and how do you clinically exclude them?
Yes, sir. So, first differential would be Duchenne and Duchenne muscular dystrophy, sir. So the signs are positive. The other things are limb girdle muscle dystrophy, but limb girdle can present at a later age group, sir, like in adolescent period only they present.
And pseudohypertrophy is less likely in
limb girdle muscular dystrophy. And mitochondrial.
What is less likely?
Pseudohypertrophy, ma'am.
No. You can have it in sarcoglycanopathy, I told you, no? So, Duchenne muscular dystrophy, limb girdle muscular dystrophy, you have autosomal dominant and autosomal recessive inherited disorders. So, autosomal dominant LGMD are rare, but autosomal recessive limb girdle muscular dystrophies are commonly seen in clinical practice, among which the most common is sarcoglycanopathy. So, the other types are calpinopathy, dysferlinopathy, Fukuyama. You have a long list actually. So, but the immediate closest differential would be a sarcoglycanopathy. Okay.
And myotonic dystrophy, and we ruled out because there was no myotonia, as and other periodic paralysis and other channelopathies were ruled out because it was not episodic and no triggering or relieving factors. No.
Endocrine, also we didn't have any symptoms suggestive or any signs suggestive of endocrinopathies leading into muscular dystrophy.
What about SMA?
SMA.
Google Berbalander.
SMA, usually there will be atrophy more than pseudohypertrophy, sir. And
reflexes?
Reflexes will be, there will be a reflex, yes, sir.
Any other DD, Professor Sangeeta?
They have already localized. Actually, if it's an anterior horn cell, they rightly said so they will have a symmetrical weakness and they have areflexia, and the wasting will be disproportionate to the weakness. So what commonly we see is the spinomuscular atrophy. The neuromuscular junction, there was no diagonal variation of reticability, and usually the muscle power would be normal, but on exercises and the forward arm abduction time would be will be a diagnostic clue at bedside. And for the peripheral neuropathy, there will be a distal more than proximal muscle weakness and areflexia, and sensory involvement would be there, which is not there in this child. So they rightly have localized to the muscle disease, and muscle disease among which it's a chronic progressive disorder. So rightly they have said it's a muscular dystrophy. So I think they have correctly localized.
Okay. What about the investigations? What investigation will you plan, Lalita?
Sir, if this child is presenting to us at the first...
Before that, did you find any complications? What are the complications that can occur? Clinically, did you identify any features suggest to complications of this?
Primary disease? So first complication could be a cardiac involvement, or it could be a cardiomyopathy presenting as congestive cardiac failure. We did not find any features, signs related to this, sir.
Features of sleep disorder, breathing?
No, sir. No snoring or no early morning headache. No symptoms suggestive, sir. And there was no frequent need for naps in the daytime, sir. And respiratory wise, there could be
reduced reserve and
single breath count was normal, sir, 20 per minute. And he had good voice volume and cough reflex also, sir, to rule out some pharyngeal and pharyngeal dysfunction.
But you said there is scoliosis.
Scoliosis.
So there could be respiratory muscle involvement. Clinically, he hasn't manifested, but we would like to confirm it by investigations.
Yes,
proceed to investigations. Okay, so, okay. You tell me, want to tell something later? Scoliosis?
Scoliosis got corrected with bending. So we, it's more of a position, postural scoliosis than
pathological one, which is due to muscular dystrophy. Can we say that, ma'am? We have that doubt.
Postural again, maybe only because of wasting, right? Of course, it hasn't gone in for a structural scoliosis, fixed scoliosis. That's what problem.
So, again, it's because of the frontal muscle weakness.
Okay.
Proceed to investigations. What investigation plan? What order?
Yes, sir. So, pertaining to this child, they already have done a genetic test, sir. But if they are presenting to us for the first time, we would like to start with CPK levels, sir. Which we would find it to be elevated in this child, and we proceed on to the genetic analysis straight away, then going on for muscle biopsy.
If genetic analysis did not give us a definitive result, it could be due to a mutation that is not yet picked up, so we could then go ahead with muscle biopsy and check out for features of muscular dystrophy, sir.
What investigation will do for complications? To identify the complications.
Yes, sir. So, cardiac wise, we need to do echocardiogram and ECG, sir. And for respiratory.
What ECG finding you will expect?
So, tall R waves in. It would be due to right ventricular hypertrophy and Q waves in V5, V6.
Okay. For the pulmonary functions, how do you assess the pulmonary function? What investigation will you use?
So we would do a pulmonary function test, sir,
plethysmography,
and we can also do a polysomnography for identifying obstructive sleep apnea, sir. And
an X-ray chest also may show collapses.
Yes. For scoliosis, we can do a baseline spinal spine X-ray. We can do, sir.
And these children are predominantly home dependent, sir, because they will in this reduction of their activity level. So there is chances of they going for vitamin D deficiency, sir. So we can check on that, sir. Vitamin D, calcium phosphate levels, alkaline phosphatase level.
DEXA can be done, sir. What will be the trend of course of the CPK? Like will be always present or always raised or
so CPK can
the course?
CPK can be,
present at birth in the newborn period.
Yes, sir, it will be present in the newborn period, sir. But there was a study which suggested that CPK can normally also be present for the first 4 days, especially so if the child has had a traumatic birth, like birth asphyxia. And so preferably to be done after the first 4 days of life. And it will be in a rising trend. So it will reach a peak by around 2 years of age, sir. And then it will fall down. So the reason for the fall in the CPK levels is because there's all the muscles would have got involved and gone into dystrophy, sir. So there might be a fall of CPK level further chronic phase, sir.
Can you tell me some confusing investigation which will be associated with the DMD? For example, DMD children also will have raised the AST and ALT.
Yes, sir. SGOT, SGP, sir. That will be raised, liver enzymes.
Aldolase also can be raised, sir. So all these are muscular enzymes also. So AST, ALT, aldolase can all be raised, but we can go for a specific enzyme like GGT for liver, sir. Then all these
liver enzymes.
Is, will the child develop any renal failure, renal impairment? Will there be any change unlike a normal child?
Yes, creatinine. We cannot use the serum creatinine values to assess the renal failure, sir. We'll have to use an alternative like a cystatin C, sir. Because creatinine itself is also a product of muscular degeneration, sir.
Over to Professor Sangeeta. Yes, Sangeeta, you're online. Madam Sangeeta.
I think she just went off. I think
disconnected.
Yeah, just got disconnected. Yeah.
Okay, we'll continue then. Okay. Can you tell me about the management of this child? Because nowadays you said genetic studies. Because nowadays genetic studies are easily available, though expensive, and it has almost replaced the muscle biopsy and EMG because they give a conclusive diagnosis, and it's also available, though it is expensive. So what further? What genetic studies will do with the child, and then for mother also will have to do, because you have to identify the genetic variation. In so that in that case, if this being a first child, probably you can also use it for during the pregnancy to identify the genetic counseling to identify the during pregnancy to prevent the birth of a child with DMD.
Yes, sir. Genetic will be a targeted genetic study, sir, with MLPA, sir, multiplex ligation dependent probe assessment or we can do multiplex PCR, sir, for both the mother and the child, sir. For the mother to detect the carrier status, we can do, sir.
And if other male siblings, they also can undergo the genetic assessment, sir.
How do you manage these kids?
Sir, first with physiotherapy, sir, for stretching exercises can be given to him. As he has a progressive symptom, we can start him on steroids, sir. Oral steroids. Usually prednisolone is given, sir. Prednisolone is given at the dose of 0.75 mg per kg per day. It can be given for 10 days on and 10 days off.
10 days in a month, sir. To be given 10 days in a month, sir. Tablet prednisolone 0.75 mg per kg per day. And other alternative medicine tablet, deflazacort can be given, sir. 0.9 mg per kg per day. That is given.
What are the mechanism of, how does they help? Steroids, how do they help in?
They reduce the inflammatory process. Based on the pathophysiology, they reduce the inflammatory process.
Okay, what are the problems due to steroids?
So, steroids per se itself, when given in a higher dose or for a longer duration of time, can aggravate muscular dystrophy, sir. And
it can lead to obesity,
proneness
to develop fractures. These are all the side effects that we have to monitor carefully. Okay, then again, stretching exercises, steroids, and what else? So, when they come regularly, come for a follow up every 3 months or 6 months, what are all the general surveillance you will do?
So, surveillance would be annual pulmonary function test can be done, sir.
After the age of 8 years, they can undergo annual pulmonary function test. And after 10 years, they can undergo cardiological evaluation with ECG, X-ray, and echo, sir. And annually, there are
orthopedic consultations. And also for to identify the contractures.
Contractures, yes.
Okay. We can advise catch up optional vaccinations like PCV, HIP, sir. Hemophilus influenza B.
So as much as possible, you also promote normal exercise, which can be done. That's, they call it submaximal. Without going to the maximum, they can have a gentle exercises like swimming or cycling. Probably that will also help to maintain the skeletal muscle function.
Yes, sir.
And it's also nutrition should be optimized, which is supplemented with proper micronutrients, vitamin D, calcium. At the same time, you should also monitor the growth chart so that he doesn't end up in obesity, which will again interfere with these functions.
So, Dr. Tangavil, sir, Dr. Sangeeta is back.
Yeah. So, what is that, Sangeeta? We are waiting for you. You went to Vellore and came back, Sangeeta. Hello? Hello?
I think she got disconnected again.
You can okay, once she, yeah, once comes, you just tell. Yes, sir.
Management, they should add also gene therapy, but also counseling, especially of the parents, as well as others, add panikonga.
Yes, sir.
In any genetic condition, it's very important. Okay, yes, for subsequent this thing or yes, near family members. Okay.
Yes, sir. Counseling and then they do the carrier testing, and then during the pregnancy also, we should check so that the delivery of a DMD
so that's baby very important. Too. Okay, this child you cannot, but at least you can
prevent for the next. Yes.
Sorry, sir, my net got interrupted.
On the management, just on the half of the management.
Sure, sir.
They told about steroids, genetic exercises. Just now, sir, this is about genetic counseling, and then
diagnosis. What genetic testing would we do?
Yes, Lita.
Sir, we, ma'am, we do a targeted genetic test, ma'am, with MLPA, ma'am, or PCR can be done. Multiplex PCR can be done.
So, what do you look look in the genetic testing?
We look for the deletion of the exon, ma'am. Usually, hotspots are there, ma'am. Particular exons 45 to 55 or 3 to 9, I guess, ma'am. We can look for the particular exon deletion, or we can screen for the entire the other 79 exons that are that may be affected, ma'am.
Okay, so it would be preferable to do an MLPA to look for the exon deletions. So not good to do a very targeted testing. Sometimes you might miss out the exon deletion. So the predominant thing is the 60% of cases, 60 to 65% will have an exon deletions. What if the exon deletion turns out to be negative and the phenotype is still suggestive of Duchenne muscular dystrophy? What testing will you plan?
Muscle biopsy we can plan, ma'am.
A muscle biopsy is an invasive test. If the parent is not willing for an invasive testing, then how will you proceed?
Then we can do whole
from peripheral blood also. We can do the genetic analysis.
Yeah, you do the blood test only. You do the genetic testing. What you MLPA you said, so that is for the exon deletion. So, if the exon deletion is negative, to confirm the diagnosis, what are the non-invasive investigations will you do?
Sanger sequencing, or you can go for confirmatory further analysis, genome sequencing, whole exome.
Yeah, you can do a dystrophin gene sequencing. So, dystrophin gene sequencing can be done. So, only 60 to 65% are due to deletions. But if the deletions are negative, then you have to look for the duplications, which will be there in around 7 to 10% of cases. And rest of the cases might have a point mutation, or they can have a missense or a frame shift mutation. So that would be picked up in the sequencing. So CPK, how much would it be elevated in children with Duchenne muscular dystrophy?
More than 15,000.
So it will be usually in more than 10,000. Okay, in early in the disease. As the disease advances, the CPK level might fall. Okay, so most of the muscular dystrophies, limb girdle muscular dystrophy and Duchenne muscular dystrophy, will have very high elevation of CPK. How will be the level of CPK in congenital myopathies?
More than 1,000.
Congenital myopathies, usually they are all inherited. Usually they have a normal CPK.
Normal.
Congenital myopathies will have a normal CPK, but a congenital muscular dystrophy will have increased CPK. Congenital muscular dystrophy would be syndromic or non-syndromic. You would have heard of like Myrosin deficient muscular dystrophy, Fukuyama's disease, you would have heard of Walker-Wahlberg muscle and muscle-eye brain disease. These are all few congenital muscular dystrophies. They will have elevated CPK, but congenital myopathies will have normal CPK. How about metabolic myopathy?
They can have normal high CPK levels also.
Metabolic myopathy, like during interim period, there might be mild elevation only. But when there is a catabolic stress, when they are presenting with a metabolic crisis, when they have present with acute metabolic crisis, they can have elevation of CPK. They can have a very high hyperCKemia. So that's why they are present with the myoglobinuria. Okay. And what will be the CPK level in neuromuscular junction disorder?
That it will be normal, ma'am.
Okay, it would be normal. Okay, so genetic testing is the preferred modality of investigation now, as of now, to confirm the diagnosis of Duchenne muscular dystrophy. So how will you differentiate between Duchenne muscular or a Becker muscular dystrophy based on the genetic testing?
It will be 5 to 20% in Becker's, ma'am. The deletion, the product will be at least 5 to 20%. But
you're saying the quantification of the dystrophin gene by Western blot technique, which is not done anywhere in the country. So how will you based on the genetic testing, how will you identify it? So when you have out of frame deletion, then the disorder would be the Duchenne muscular dystrophy. So in frame deletion, then as in frame mutation, then you have the Becker muscular dystrophy. That is why they have a lesser severe phenotype. Okay, so what are the investigations will you be doing in a children with Duchenne muscular dystrophy other than CPK and other to look for the other systemic involvement? What are the testing you need?
Yes, ma'am. For systemic involvement, we start with echocardiogram and ECG to look for cardiac involvement, ma'am. Okay. And for respiratory involvement, we do a chest X-ray, pulmonary function test, and plethysmography can be done, ma'am.
polysomnography.
Polysomnography. Yes, sleep.
You can do an overnight spirometry. You can do a saturation, oxygen saturation monitor overnight, and morning blood gas, RT-PCR blood gas can be done. And also you can do a spirometry, and also you can do a polysomnography to look for the respiratory muscle involvement. And for cardiac, you already said ECG and echo can be done. What other investigations will you be doing? This child had a scoliosis. So you will also do an X-ray spine to look for the COPS angle, the severity of the scoliosis. Huh? Okay. And what other investigations will you order? Because this child is an X-linked recessive disorder. So you have to screen the other sibling as well as the mother to look for the mother could be a carrier, and the other asymptomatic child, you have to screen where he could be a Becker phenotype or he could be asymptomatic. So you have to do the screening of family members with CPK, particularly the mother and the siblings. Okay.
So Sangeeta, how much MRI is useful in these kids?
Muscle imaging has been used in certain limb girdle muscular dystrophy, sir, but for Duchenne muscular dystrophy, we don't use it. And for even for the limb girdle muscular dystrophy, the genetic testing has actually now replaced all of these investigations.
Okay, but thank you.
Please proceed. How will you manage?
Ma'am, management, we involve in a multidisciplinary team for the child, ma'am. And for this child, we start off steroids because there's a progressive worsening of the muscular.
Before starting steroids, what all investigations will you do?
MANTO should be done to rule out TB, ma'am.
Okay. Chest X-ray to rule out latent TB infection, you'll do a MANTO. And what all you should emphasize?
Steroids, we should emphasize for... to watch out for complications, ma'am, because obesity can be a complication of steroid intake, and obesity can per se weaken the movement or ambulation of the child, ma'am. So that is first thing that we need to tell the parents. And physiotherapy should be routinely advised, and moderate amount of physical activity should be advised for the child, ma'am.
Which steroid would you prefer to give?
Prednisolone.
If the parent family is affordable, would you still write a prednisolone, or you would
deflazacort, ma'am? Because of lesser complications with deflazacort, we prefer deflazacort.
What's the dose of steroid, prednisolone and deflazacort?
Steroids, it is 0.75 mg per kg per day, ma'am, given for 10 days in a month, and deflazacort is 0.9 mg per kg per day, ma'am,
to be given on 2 days of the week, ma'am.
So what is this regimen? 2 days in a week and 10 days in a month?
Weekend only regimen is there. And 10 day off and 10 day on regimen.
Yeah, there are so many regimens, the Dubowitz, Connolly and all. But what is currently recommended regimen for the for the treatment of children?
Daily.
Yeah, you have to give prednisolone 0.75 mg per kg per day as a single dose every day. Okay. Or you can give deflazacort 0.9 mg per kg per day. So the advantage of deflazacort there would be lesser weight gain, and there would be lesser systemic side effects when compared to the prednisolone, but there will be a high risk for the asymptomatic cataracts. So what are the things that you will monitor when the child is on steroid? Before starting steroid, you should ensure that the child receives
all the live vaccines, vaccination
is complete. And then you also have to advise pneumococcal vaccine and the flu vaccines. Huh?
Yes, ma'am.
So while the child is on steroid, what are things will you monitor while the child comes for review to your clinic?
Growth and height, growth monitoring, ma'am. Height and development should be seen, ma'am. And we should also check for hypertension, hyperglycemia, and hyperlipidemia, other metabolic complications. And osteopenia can also be present, ma'am. So that also should be looked into. And weight gain should be optimized, nutrition wise should be optimized. And steroid, other complications can be cataract. Ophthal evaluation should be done to look for cataracts.
Okay, so at follow-up visit, you will do investigation to look for the progression of the disease, and also you will do a clinical assessment as well as investigation to look for the adverse effects related to the medications. So to look for the progression of the disease, you will do a power charting. Every visit, you have to do a detailed power charting, and also you have a certain scales to assess the Vigno scale and Brook scale to assess the upper limb and lower limb function. So it's a very simple scale where they grade the upper limb power and the lower limb power based on the functional status. So that will be done on the follow-up. So that is to assess for the progression of the disease. And also you can also look at the Gower's time also. What is the time taken to rise from the sitting position to the standing position? So what is the time? That time taken also could also be one of a measure to assess for the progression. And other thing is you have to look for the growth, as you said, whether there is an excessive weight gain on steroid, you have to assess. And also you have to look at the blood pressure, bed size. And if the child is ambulant, then you can do a spirometry as well as a echocardiography. A spirometry yearly you can do, and an echocardiography once in 2 years you can do, less than 10 years. But if the child has become non-ambulant, then you have to do a frequent every 6 monthly spirometry, and yearly echocardiography has to be done. Okay, and then you have to do blood investigation to look for the steroid-related adverse effects. One is that you have to look at the fasting blood sugars, lipid profile. And also you have to look at the calcium and vitamin D status, and they're more prone for osteopenia as you discussed. So DEXA scan yearly can also be done if they become non-ambulant and if they're on steroids for a very long time. Okay. So the child, and also off-the-label evaluation, as you rightly mentioned, to look for the glaucoma as well as the cataract. So you have to do periodically. So in case if the child is coming to you for a regular follow-up, if the child has an excessive weight gain on prednisolone, so what will you advise?
Physical activity and nutrition to be optimized, ma'am. And
yeah, father has optimized everything. So still there is excessive weight gain. Then what will you do?
You can change it to alternate day regimen, ma'am. Daily steroids can be changed to alternate.
No, you can reduce the dose from 0.75 milligram per kg per day. You can reduce the dosage by 25 to 30%. So then you can monitor the weight gain on that dose. So the minimum effective dose that has been proven to be effective in children with Duchenne muscular dystrophy, prednisolone, is 0.3 milligram per kg per day. So you can come down with the dosage, and then you can advise the exercises as well as the dietary modification, and then you can follow up. Okay. So, and then in addition, you will give the genetic counseling. So what you have to explain the parents the risk of recurrence, and in case if the family is planning for the next baby, so you have to offer the prenatal diagnosis to them. So what are the newer modalities of treatment in children with Duchenne muscular dystrophy?
There is
some
therapy and...
exon skipping is available, ma'am.
Okay. So you have you heard of Ataluren?
Yes, ma'am.
So Ataluren has also been tried in children with Duchenne muscular dystrophy. Exon skipping has been tried, and even gene therapy trials are also in place. So
what about stem cell transplant? Is it useful or not found to be useful?
So stem cell, like a mesenchymal stem cell transplant, would actually not like a commonly used like an exon skipping. So it might be beneficial in children with Duchenne muscular dystrophy. So, but the commonly used which is coming up is the exon skipping. There are other drugs as well, that utrophin upregulators. And also like myostatin inhibitors. So there are many other drugs which have been tried, and even creatine monohydrate also have been tried.
Moderators, can I please ask to wind up in 5 minutes? Thank you.
Sure, sir.
Last question, end of the life care. Nowadays, most of them are very clearly followed up with the neurologists or a general pediatrician. So the end of life care also we have to plan when the child is almost in the terminal stages. So probably we can leave the choice to the parent. There are two types of parents. One group of parents may say that I also want that Sangeeta's experience also. One group of pediatricians, one group of parents will like to keep the child in the hospital without doing further, almost in the last days of the child. And second group might prefer to keep the child at home because in front of all the relatives and the child can be kept at home. So based on their interest and based on their convenience and comfort, probably we'll have to offer the terminal care also to them.
To improve the quality of life, like even if the children become non-ambulant, to preserve the upper limb function, cardiac and pulmonary function, we still advocate steroid for them. And for children who have cardiac muscle involvement, cardiomyopathy, you have to get an expert opinion and then start on medication to reduce the afterload. And for children with respiratory muscle involvement, earlier you intervene, the better would be the quality of life. So non-invasive ventilation can be started at home itself. But for children who progress to a state where they are non-ambulant, we have a severe cardiac and respiratory muscle involvement, the overall prognosis has to be discussed with the family, and it has to be decided by the family. And it also depends upon the affordability as well as the availability of resources.
And also support groups and respite care for the parents and all that. Is it possible, Sankita, now? Respite care for the parents and then support group supporting each other. Is it all possible in a place like CMC Vellore?
It's coming up in a few cities, but it'll take time. So ideal situation is different, but practicality, especially with COVID,
nobody wants it. Yeah. Sir, any last question from your side, sir? Srinivasan, sir.
Because I already put the chat box, everything she has covered, and excellent discussion. Sorry, I joined a bit late because, you know, that was very interesting and they wanted me to be there till the end. And the adolescent Dr. Preeti Galagali and this thing. So, otherwise, I was keen to join. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Sangeeta, can we wind up?
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much, Srinivasan.